And I'm artistic director of Dance and Be More. And every third Sunday of the month, we usually go live on Facebook and Instagram. So you might see some folks roaming around because this is sort of a Facebook, Instagram takeover by Voices of Carmen and our young people in our youth program. And we're excited to introduce this program. And I want to give you a quick little backstory, and then I'm going to shut up and I'm going to let our young people share a little bit more about the project. So 11 years ago, I wrote an adaptation of Carmen. And my brother and I did the project in Zurich, Switzerland. It was a 9-month project with a youth cast, youth orchestra, and I went back and forth from New York to Zurich. I directed it, I wrote it, my brother and I co-choreographed it, and it was a phenomenal project. I learned so much. I learned so much from the young people that I was working with, and I thought, wow, this is really rich material that I would love to do again, and I would love to do it in the United States. And but we're just gonna see what happens and when is gonna be that time, right? And so I've been waiting, having a couple conversations, and this last May, I was talking with a young woman, her name is Maya, who happens to be the person who does all of our artwork for Voices of Carmen. I was talking to her and her mom about some of the challenges that are facing our youth with how to resolve conflicts and how conflicts come up inside of our schools, inside of our communities, and how this piece has several conflicts in it that might be a great way to start a conversation about the different choices that we make and the sort of crossroads that we're at that lead us down one road or another. So she gave me some really great feedback and advice, and I love getting advice from young people, and from that I started writing. And as I started rewriting, I felt like a faucet was open and it just started coming to me, you know? And I was like, wow, I think this might be a thing, this might be time. And so then I started pulling in some more young people like Christian and Faith and Adema and Catherine, and talking to them about the project and the energy that they were giving back. And the feedback that they were giving was making me know that it is time, not for me in this project, but for them inside of this project, and for us to have Voices of Carmen as an opportunity for youth voices to be heard around a number of different topics. So that's sort of the origin of it. It started back in May. Over the summer, we went into the studio, recorded several songs, and so tonight what we're going to hear are some of the songs from Carmen, a few from Act 1, a few from Act 2, and the key here is that we want you to hear them and give us feedback as we go along this process. It's a year-long process. The show is going to be auditioning in Baltimore, March, so if you're a young person who would like to be a part of it, singers, dancers, actors, it will have a youth cast and a youth orchestra, so musicians, we welcome you as well. And then the show will be done at Baltimore School for the Arts, but it's open to all students from all over Baltimore. July 8th is when we start Camp Carmen. And we'll do 3 performances in Baltimore and then culminate that performance by going to DC and doing a performance on the Millennium Stage at the Kennedy Center. So this is a very exciting time for us to take this journey with our cast, with our team, and thank you for taking the journey with us and helping us along the way by giving us your words of wisdom and your feedback. So we look forward to hearing from you. So without any further ado, I want to introduce you to our Carmen Youth Council and let them introduce themselves to you.
Hi, I'm Noelle. I'm 15 years old and I'm a 10th grader.
Hi, I'm Jade. I'm 17 years old and I'm an 11th grader.
Hi everyone, my name is Adema and I am in the 14th grade.
Hi, I'm Catherine. I'm 14 years old and I'm in the 9th grade.
Hi, I'm Faith. I'm 16 years old and I'm in the 11th grade.
Hi, my name is Imani. I'm 17 years old and I'm in the 12th grade.
Hi, my name is Jared. I'm 16 and I'm in the 11th grade.
Hi, my name is Christian. I'm 17 and I'm in the 11th grade.
Awesome. So these are some of the young people who have influenced the storyline, the music, and just sort of all the parts of Carmen, and will continue to do so. And now we have some of them who are going to share an introduction about this project overall that we call Power in the Process.
Development process examining youth, voices, and choices.
Voices and choices.
A show with human experiences
Agitation.
Longing.
Jealousy.
Fear.
Anger.
Aggression.
And death.
A theatrical production set in a high school.
A high school?
A production creating a safe space for dialogue. This is a creative space.
A shame-free space.
An urban musical adaptation of a classic tale.
A production providing a template for youth leadership and multi-generational theatrical development. Dance and Be More's Voices of Carmen.
Carmen.
Carmen. Carmen. Carmen. A creative collaboration and conversation. We, the Carmen Youth Council, invite you to follow our year-long journey and discover the power in the process. Hello.
Hello again. Before we begin hearing demos from the show, we want to draw your attention to your feedback pages.
We will listen to three songs from Act 1, then pause for feedback using the critical response process.
As each song is being played, feel free to write down your thoughts, and at intermission, we will guide you through one or two steps of the critical response process.
If you are watching online, feel free to write your comments and feedback if you would like to hear from the creative team.
And now let's begin.
Students in Ms. Schuler's literature class have been reading the novel Carmen by Prosper Mérimée, which George Bizet based his opera, Carmen.
In an effort to bring this text to life, Ms. Schuler has instructed her students to not just read, but act out the story together as a class.
Each day, she brings props and accessories to accompany the students, telling of the classic tale in their own unique way.
At this point in the story, we are in the town of Seville, which has a military base that employs many of the men and a cigarette factory which the town's women are at work.
The song, Habanera, marks Carmen's entrance, and as she does, all eyes are now on her.
In our telling of the story, this Carmen is a dancer with a captivating presence.
Midway through the song, lights come up on the music room of the high school, where student musicians are also playing Habanera, as it is being acted out by Ms. Schuler's class.
One of the music students stands to sing the verse. In Ms. Schuler's class, Carmen the dancer is not impressed.
Underwhelmed by the attempts of the young men in the scene to woo her over and hold her attention.
Across the room, there is one soldier who is waiting for his fiancée, Micaela, to return and has not given Carmen a second look.
After noticing she has failed to capture his attention, Carmen begins to laser focus on winning Don Jose Gates through a fast-paced dance of beckoning.
Thank you.
story takes place after Don Jose has been placed in jail for losing his prisoner, Carmen.
What?
Right. Well, Carmen got into a huge fight with another girl at the cigarette factory, which got her arrested by soldiers and earned her a night in detention. And guess which soldier was assigned to take her there?
Don Jose.
Boom. Yep, so the whole time he's taking her to jail and she's batting her eyes and trying to get him to set her free and free himself from his little mousy girlfriend, Micaela, and be her mate.
Ooh.
So she gets Don Jose to let his guard down, and when he does, she runs away.
So now he's lost his prisoner and he's about to lose his job?
The captain has Don Jose put in detention for this. But while he's in jail, Carmen writes to him to say she really does have feelings for him and hates that he's in there because of her. Feeling bad and heartsick over this new guy, Carmen has become a downer to her two friends, Mercedes and Francisquita.
We did not make these names up. That's George Bizet from around the way.
Anyway, this next song, Carmen Blue, is in a nightclub just after an ensemble of people dancing and having a good time with a fantastic live band.
Off in the corner is sad-faced Carmen looking blue.
Liz Lerman. And so the first step is statements of meaning.
And that is what is meaningful, evocative, interesting, exciting, and anything striking from what you have to see.
So we would love if you all would raise your hands and just say anything that really touched your heart or touched your mind during this whole listening process. Would anyone like to start?
I really liked in Carmen Blue how it felt really when the music shifted to emphasizing like the triplets and the beat, when it was like dun 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 dun. That like really started to like get that sort of growing sense of rhythm right there.
Thank you. Did you have your hand up?
I think this is great. I love the idea of it, just taking such a standard and well-known piece as Carmen and, you know, updating it and providing an urban story for it. It just, I feel like it is going to bring people together who are watching it, so love it.
Anyone else?
Anything that you found interesting, exciting, that you would like to share? Well, another step of the critical response process is neutral questions. So it's a question that does not include your opinion. It's just something along the lines of, what ideas guided you to choose this sort of music for this particular song? Or what inspired you to have this pace for this song? Would anyone have any neutral questions that you would like to ask?
When you do like the whole piece, when you really envision like the finished product, how do you envision how will this music be performed?
All right, so the way that we see it is that the school has two classrooms that we are able to look into. One is Ms. Schuler's class, who's acting out this piece, and the other class is the music class, who is actually practicing Carmen at the same time. And so there's times where the lights will come up on the music class and they're, you know, in their rehearsal process. And so we'll see that. And then there's times when the lights will go out on them and we have some little secrets of how we sort of hide that group at times when we want to focus in on Ms. Schuler's class. So.
You mind if I hopefully still maintain neutrality but ask a slightly more specific version of the same thing? I'm wondering how, since in the recorded ones we heard there, it seems kind of important to the music that there is some electronic sounds and some live sounds, both. And I'm wondering, would the musicians that you just talked about then be sort of, you know, manipulating both electronic and live sounds?
The short answer is yes.
Okay, great.
And so one of the next stages of this process is hiring the right musical director. We've got incredible music producers, and I want to just take this opportunity to give a shout out to. We've got Mr. Winston Phillip here. And also with us, if you've been hearing things from, is Vaughn Marcus right over here. And so it's really going to be a true collaboration. I've written all of the songs as well as the lyric, but we definitely talked through sort of what does this feel like, what's the style, and I want to create it so that in Baltimore we have so much talent. We have incredible musicians, and it's like nothing to say that your, you know, class of musicians would be able to play this material, but somewhere else they may not have all of that access, and so you can use as much instrumentation or as little instrumentation as you have at your disposal. And so we're trying to build it smart so that it's really accessible for any high school or college to be able to really pull off and do well.
Are there any other neutral questions that anyone would like to share?
Don't be shy.
Yes.
Are there modern versions of the song?
Yes. So these are samples of the songs, and his question was, are there longer versions of the song? And yes, there are, especially once you start to build out the stage and the dance numbers that go with them. But this at least gives sort of a proof of concept.
Did you have a question?
Yeah, I have so many questions. Do you have a target audience? And if so, is there one, and you may have said this at the very beginning, I didn't hear everything, is there one sort of message or point that you have that you want to come across?
So I'll answer the last question first. I tend to not, so there are themes.
Yeah.
But I don't like to prescribe what the message is. I like people to discover their own message, because sometimes they'll discover something that I was like, oh, that's in there. And I'm glad that it landed on them that way. A theme within the show are crossroads and that pivotal moment in time where you could go one way or the other. And that decision making, that crossroads, and where your life will go leading down that road and where your life might go leading down that road. And so that keeps coming up, and I think that's going to be a part of the lighting inside the piece as well, that we visually see these crossroads come up inside the piece. And then I can't remember your first question.
Target audience
is anybody and everybody. My hope is that this becomes cross-generational. That when you say family theater, that actual, you know, parents and high school students can go to the theater and watch this, have a conversation about some of the topics that are going on inside the Carmen. And also because we're designing and building it, we call it Voices of Carmen, a creative collaboration and conversation. It's built for dialogue. It's built to actually talk about what we're seeing. And so my hope is that can be multi-generational.
Any other questions? Okay, well, oh, yes?
When you say that it's built for dialogue, like I've seen some productions where they do the full performance and then they involve the audience afterwards. Is this something you envision doing after performing it, like having audience dialogue after your performances?
Yes, there's definitely some feedback and conversation and engagement that happens with the audience. It's a little more throughout when it comes to Carmen. We're going to save up some of that for the actual show, you know, as a little top secret. When folks come, they'll be like, no, 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 no. So I'm not going to say everything, but there will be opportunity for people to talk with it.
Okay. Any other questions? Last call for questions for this part? All right, well, I think now we can move on to Act 2.
Act 2, all right. Thank you so much to our young ladies. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about Act 2. So we start out in the classroom. Ms. Shuler is trying to help her young people understand this literature. It feels really dry and really boring to them for a while. So she's like, let's get on our feet. Let's act it out. Let's try this. As they do that, they're more engaged. She loves that. But she keeps noticing that there's this one young man who is looking at the story in a way that's just a little different from all the rest of the students, and she's not quite sure why. And then when they get to the point where Carmen receives the letter that she just got, he comes in and he stops the show and says, wait a minute, I know this story. This is my sister's story. And so at the top of Act 2, we meet Thrupp. And he comes in and gives his narration of where he's from and where his sister is from. And we call this the flip. And now we tell the entire story in an urban setting. So we're out of the classroom and just in his neighborhood telling the rest of Carmen that way. And so this song is called Desert Rose, and we have Imani.
Desert rose in a drop from a world, living much too fast for such a young girl. My sister, she was blooming on the rough side of town. And sometimes when you grow, keeps your mentality down. But you couldn't tell her nothing, she was doing her thing. While mama cursed and screamed about her friends in the game. I wish I could go back and tell her which road to choose. But in the game, in the hood, you gotta pay your own dues. She fell hard with this dude named DJ, and her heart got broke when the cops took him away. She waited and debated whether she should stay true, and her mom got mad when she didn't go home to school. But then she got word he was free as a bird. He committed and greeted her And when she heard, these signs are good news, but I wish I could go back and tell her which road to choose.
I don't know how, but I know more. I was defensive.
And so she decides that she doesn't want to be with him anymore, but he just thinks, we just have a fight. We're going to make up. And he walks off to sort of blow off some steam. But she's like, I'm going to go hang with my girls. And as she's hanging out with her girls, they're reading tarot cards. And as they're reading the tarot cards and they throw down a card for Carmen, the card of death comes up. So Carmen's like, please throw another card. So they throw down another card, and the card of death comes up again. So she's like, I'm going to need you to shuffle the cards. So they shuffle the cards, and you know everybody's doing things. They throw down the card, it's the card of death again. And now it is real for her, that apparently death is coming, and it's coming for me. And so she's feeling very anxious about this, and moves away from her friends and her team, and just sort of goes off to a dark place. And in that dark place of isolation, sometimes the little whispers start to come in your mind and make you feel insecure. And so these are some of the voices that are in her head as she thinks about what she's grown up with, the superstitions she's had, and also what's coming down the line for her.
Yeah, that's all I have over here.
Yeah, I just like the flip from the school to the street.
building towards the fact that, though, this is becoming real now. So you kind of feel that growth of the reality check through the music, because it starts out minimal, so you know it's a small awareness, but as she becomes aware that, oh wow, this is really happening, you feel the drama going on in her heart. Like the music kind of really paints that picture very well. Like it paints the drama that's going on in her, and you hear all these elements come in, you hear the harmonies grow, and so now you're really in her head through the music. So I thought that was done really well to convey that. Everything that described in the beginning came through in the music.
Thank you.
Also sounds lovely to him.
Any other statements of meaning? Okay, well now we would like to move on to mutual questions.
No, number two.
Oh, number two. Okay.
Yeah. So step two in critical response is where I can ask y'all questions. And you can answer as directly as you want. So I will stick in act two. For Desert Rose, what were some of the visuals that were coming to mind for you as the brother told this story? Were there any visuals that came to mind?
Well, I like just following the question where you answered the crossroads being really important. I like the fact that you said crossroads, and also the background mixing of the solo. So it was like monologue, and then the background voices came in, and it felt like the people in the neighborhood were like there.
Thank you. And she was like, I really like Voices of Carmen. I said, what would you prefer? She said, Voices of Carmen, because it's more than one person speaking. It's multiple voices and multiple points of view, and it sort of begs to be a listener. And I was like, okay. And in my mind, I still wasn't settled, because I was still like, well, I needed to do this, this, and this, and I went home and I prayed about it. And then, just in the stillness, I was like, she's right. She's 16 and she's right. And so the next day, when she was in the office and sort of got some of the material that said Voices of Carmen on it, you can see her being like, like, just my idea. So, yeah, so it was her suggestion of the list of things that we had, Voices of Carmen, and now I love it.
So she gets worth it.
It was like 45 minutes.
plus, you know, the 15 minutes of Q&A. This is now 2 acts, so it'll easily be just, it won't quite be 2 hours, but it'll be close to, I think. I want to say a special, couple special, oh, any more questions? All right, let me get some thank yous in. I want to say thank you to our ladies, Jade and Noelle. Yay!
voicesofcarmen@gmail.com, so feel free to email us any of your ideas. As CJ also mentioned, we have our demos on SoundCloud, so you just go on SoundCloud and search Voices of Carmen and you'll see our playlist come up. And if you enjoyed this, which I hope you all did, you can follow us at #VoicesofCarmen on both Instagram and Facebook, so please make sure to like us and follow us there. And please, take a favor, we have our very own Voices of Carmen that you can take home and keep wearing in those winter months. And please save the date and tell your teens that auditions are March 2nd, 3rd, and 4th in 2019.
Awesome. Great. So things to help you remember, because that was a lot of information. This has all your audition information on it. Grab this with you. If you see a friend, it has what the dancers, singers, and actors need to prepare. This has all the SoundCloud information. Pass these out, spread the word, have people listen to the music. This is Voices of Carmen Chapstick. This will get you through the winter, okay? And if you want to know about this project and some of the fundraising that we're going to do to get ready for it and the timeline, everything you need is in here. The next time that you can hear some Voices of Carmen and actually see some dances from the show, save the date, November 2nd, we're going to be at Charm City Fringe Festival at Broadway Live, and we'll do He's Coming with choreography. So, the dance company has been working on that for a while. We'll be ready to debut that on Friday, November 2nd at the Charm City Fringe Festival. And then on November 17th, we are a part of the National Guild Community Arts and Education. Dance to Be More is a site visit, so people will come see us up at the Lower House. And the first half of our program will be all the things that Dance to Be More does with elders.
Motor House on North Avenue. And then the last dates to remember are March 2nd, 3rd, 4th. That's when young people can audition. And then in May, we will be recording the cast album with whoever's been cast in the show. The way that we're building this project is that it's going to be a youth work project so that the young people are paid for their work with Carmen over the summer. It's July 8th through July 30th. They perform at BSA. They can be from any school. We will have an audition in North Baltimore, East Baltimore, West Baltimore, South Baltimore, and Central Baltimore. So whatever part of Baltimore is closest to that young person, that's the audition they should come to. And then once we've assembled our cast, we'll do three shows here, one show at the Kennedy Center, and then we'll have our cast party right here on August 4th, Lord willing. All right? Thank you all so